Maude will become the site of the greatest greenhouse gas emissions in the world. In the last throne speech, the government announced deregulation of offshore drilling and mining in the north. So we already have another fight on our hands because when they talk about overregulation, what they mean is territorial, provincial, federal, and First Nations regulations, and they want to do away with all of that and make it very easy. Well, anybody who's watching the oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico, which has just arrived in the Gulf of Mexico and it's going to be devastating, should think about, do we want offshore oil rigs up in Canada's north? The only good thing that may come out of this disaster with the oil spill in the U.S. is that Obama today announced that maybe he's going to give second thought to his move towards offshore oil rigs. So it's a hard way to learn a lesson, but maybe it is being learned. And I just want to say, because I notice a lot of students in the room, it's really important that people like me don't come in and say, okay, it's really a mess up there, and you guys, it's all your job to clean it up. We're really sorry we made such a mess. And I really don't want to do that. I think there's some wonderful stories and some wonderful hope, and I think it's a generation-to-generation struggle that we have. So I'm really conscious that's not a good thing to do, but at the same time, we have to take a good look at what we're dealing with. And when we know what we're dealing with, then take steps to make it better. So really quickly, I'm just going to go over, because I want to have some time to chat with you, what is the story with the global water crisis? And it's very important that we kind of get a handle on this, because when you hear about the water crisis, most of us think one of two things. We think about all the people without water, but we think it's an issue of poverty and injustice, which it is. But it's also, we don't understand how much it's also an ecological issue. So we hear that, and it's true, that every year about 3.5 million people in our world die of waterborne disease. It's the greatest killer of children, more than HIV, AIDS, war, and accidents put together. I mean, if we could wipe out dirty water, if we could find a solution to polluted or non-existent access to water in the global south, we could wipe out about 85% of all illness and disease in the world. We're talking about, you know, the vast majority of illness being related to waterborne disease. Or when we hear about water, we think about it from a climate change point of view, and here's that story. That story goes, using too many greenhouse gases, the fossil fuel emissions are creating global warming, the global warming is affecting water, which is true. Again, this is true in the form of glacial melt. I was just in Bolivia last week where the Andes are melting, and when they're melted, these people are not going to have any water because they are a landlocked country, poorest country in Latin America, and literally whole cultures and communities are being moved off these mountains where they're food self-sufficient, where they've lived for centuries. And now they're becoming part of the peri-urban poor in the slums in Latin America. And we hear that, you know, that global warming makes the evaporation of lakes and rivers and so on take place quickly. All that's true. But here's the part that you're not hearing, and that I want to say to you as strongly as I can. When we hear about drought in the world, cyclical drought, that's not really correct. Really, we're a planet running out of clean water. And the reason that's so hard for us to get into our heads is that when we were in about grade 6, somebody taught us that you can't run out of water, that there's a finite amount of water in the hydrologic cycle, right? It goes round and round and round, that you can't ruin it. You can't destroy it, so you can use all you want. It turns out that, and our teachers weren't lying, but they weren't right either, that here's the reality. As we become so-called more sophisticated, more industrialized, more urbanized, more consumer-oriented, we use more and more and more water. And the graphs showing the population growth and the use of water growth are quite extraordinary. We are using water far faster than population growth. So it's not a direct relationship only to the numbers of people on the planet. It's our use and abuse of water. It's the globalization of everything, so that the average food plate, dinner plate in North America has taken, 1,800 kilometers to get to us. That's using energy, but that's using water. Our clothes all used to be made here in North America not very long ago. Most, only about 5% of all the clothes worn and sold in the United States and Canada are made here. So they use tremendous amount of that industry uses a tremendous amount of water to make, to destroy, because all the dyes, the cheap dyes that are used and so on, get dumped in water systems around the world, and then tons of energy to come here. As we globalize, as we industrialize, we are using too much water. As we industrialize our food system, and we move to intensive livestock operations, and we move again to this massive movement of food around the world, and we move to biofuels, which take about 1,700 kilometers to make 1 kilometer, kilometers of water to produce 1 kilometer of corn ethanol, as we move towards this, we are destroying water around the world. We're taking water from aquifers, we're now pumping groundwater all over the world far faster than it can be replenished, and we're using technology that didn't exist 40 years ago. So it's happening really quickly. We used to have wells, but we never used to have bore wells that go down into the ground as deeply as great big skyscrapers go up in the sky, and we're pumping water from the groundwater systems around the world so fast that we are literally physically running out. Sometimes we're taking that water just into massive, great big cities, and if those cities are anywhere near the ocean, we're dumping that water as waste in the ocean. And that's one of the reasons that the oceans are rising. This is really important for us to understand. It's not just global warming and the ice caps melting. I'm working with scientists in Slovakia that estimate we take about 700 trillion liters of land-based water. This is water not flowing into the ocean, but water in aquifers and lakes and so on, and pumping it into cities and dumping it into the ocean every single year. We also take water and we grow crops in deserts that we have no right to be doing because those deserts do not, the deserts can't sustain it. And so when you have an oasis in a desert, eventually you've got two deserts. The so-called Aral Sea, which was a lake in the former Soviet Union that was so big they called it a sea, the Aral Sea, was used to produce cotton in the desert, and is pretty well gone now. And this is a lesson for us with the Great Lakes. If we ever think there's such a thing as a body of water too large to be destroyed, actually no, there isn't. We have other examples.